What's up, everybody? Welcome back to science class. This is going to be our second episode in our Unit 1 Earth Systems video series. In this video, we're going to continue our work taking a look at our planet and all of the wonderful different systems that can be found keeping our planet the way we know it and recognize it today. So let's go ahead and get started. So as always, in today's video, you're going to need to have your science interactive notebook open so you can follow along and take notes along with it. You can find your science notebook under the classwork tab. Look for a posting that has today's date on it. When you open that up, that'll have all of the pages you need to follow along with this video here. So, just a quick review from last week's video. In last week's video, we took a look at all of the different things we could find on our planet, and we came up with a way to organize it. So we looked at Earth's four different spheres. There's the geosphere, the biosphere, the hydrosphere, and the atmosphere. These four spheres include all things that we find naturally on our planet, from the ground under our feet, to the sky up above us, to the water we drink, to our very selves, and how we fit into the planet as a whole. So now that we have a good foundation of those four spheres, what we're going to do now is we're going to start going into each sphere in more detail. We're going to be going through all four over the course of these videos, and the first one we're going to take a look at is the biosphere. The biosphere is an extremely diverse sphere containing lots of different living things, from us to the birds to the fish to the grass, trees, and the bugs themselves as well. All of those fall under the category of the biosphere. And so if we're going to understand how it works, we need to take a look at some similarities between all those living things and also their differences. So in terms of things in the biosphere, they may look different, they may have different abilities, they may live in different places, but one thing that they all have in common is that they are alive. And for any living body, no matter the species, in order for them to perform the things they need to do to stay alive, like for us humans to be able to move around and breathe and eat and sleep and do all the things we need to have energy in order to do so. This is critical in allowing the different species of Earth to be able to do the things they need to do in order to survive. So we directly have evidence for this. If we think to our actual lives, if we think about days where we feel ourselves having a lot of energy, right? We're excited, we're in a good mood, we can kind of run around, we can do what we need to do, right? Those days are always tend to be much better than days where we're not feeling great, when we're low energy, right? Everything seems like such a struggle, right? We're tired, we don't want to do things, right? So our energy levels directly affect our ability to do stuff. And that's great for humans because for us, we're not really in a day-to-day battle for survival. But if you think about other living things where every decision they make and everything they do is to stay alive, energy becomes very important. And all the different living things on the planet, they get their energy in different ways. For humans, we tend to eat food, right? If we eat a lot of sugar, we have a lot of energy, right? If we eat certain foods, we feel better. But I've never seen a tree eat anybody. So there's different ways in which living things can get their energy. And the way in which living things acquire the energy they use to survive is one of the best ways we can sort of organize them. And that's what we're going to take a look at in this video. So the first category we can use to organize living things is many living things are considered what we call producers. Okay, so this particular type of living thing, they get their energy by making their own food. So producers have the ability to make their own food. They can go through a process called photosynthesis, which we'll talk about later, and they have the ability to make their own food. And they do this by using energy that they obtain from the sun up ahead of us, right? Examples of things like this are going to be things like trees, flowers, the grass, and generally all plants we find on the planet. They have the ability to take the sunlight and can use it to make their own food internally to have the energy they need to survive. Some evidence to support this from our own real life observations is think about where you tend to see plants grow. Plants need sunlight in order to grow. We see them outside. We don't see plants growing inside in the dark, right? And that's because they need to get the energy from the sun. If they are cut off from the sun, they don't have the energy they need, and then this causes them to die. So that's a bit of real life evidence we can use to support this. So at this point, quick pause, make sure you're following along in your notebooks. This will correspond with the producers page. So make sure you fill in the blanks from what we just talked about on your notebook page. Pause the video if you need to before we go ahead and move on. So up next, we have the consumers. So consumers are where we find ourselves. Consumers are living things that get their energy from eating other things. They go out and they take their own food. So just how producers, they can make their own food, consumers take it by going out and either hunting or acquiring food from other places. Primarily, consumers get their energy by eating either producers, which would be eating plants, we tend to call those herbivores, or by eating other smaller consumers, which would be eating things like meat that come from animals, and those would be considered carnivores. Some examples of consumers would be like humans, lions, cows, wolves, and generally considering all animals, most animals would fall into this category, right? And even animals that eat plants would be considered a consumer because they're eating another living thing, or animals that hunt other animals would be considered consumers because they're getting their energy by eating another living thing as well. So we fall in here. Even us as humans, we don't really think about it, but if we're eating vegetables or something from a plant, that's eating a living thing. And then even if we end up eating meat, that's coming from another living thing as well, which puts us into the consumer category. Make sure you jot down these consumer notes into your notebooks on the correct page. And again, sort of going over it, right, the idea behind consumers is that they're consuming something else in order to get their energy. Whether they're consuming plants or consuming a smaller consumer, this is generally how they get their energy there. Finally, our final group we call decomposers. Now, decomposers are kind of the weird ones, right? These are things we don't normally think about. We have plants and we have animals and they're producers and consumers. That's pretty straightforward. But decomposers are a little bit strange. So when we look at decomposers, what their job is they tend to be the ones that break down leftover dead or waste material that's left behind from other things. So, for example, if an animal were to die in the woods, let's say, decomposers would kind of go in and they would break that body down and they would pull their energy from the body or the waste material that was left behind. They would eat the leftover scraps. These tend to be smaller things, right? These tend to be worms, bugs, bacteria, stuff that can't necessarily go out and hunt something that's live. So what they have to do is they have to wait for the scraps to fall to them. So a large consumer like a bear might go hunting and kill something. It might get its energy by eating what it wants, and then anything that's left over, the decomposers will come in and break it down. So this serves a great purpose because it allows when something dies for it not to be wasted, right? Consumers take what they need and anything that's left over can go to the decomposers. And this also helps to break things down. For example, this is proven by the fact that if you leave something outside for long amounts of times, it begins to decay and break down, right? And that's because there's decomposers there that might be too small for us to see that are eating away at it and breaking it down. And so this forms our sort of final group of living things in our category. So finally, make sure you record your information down for decomposers in your scientific notebooks. So if we look at all living things in our biospheres, we can actually put all of them into these three categories. Now, some living things may dabble and sort of go across lines. You might see consumers that dabble on leftover waste material. And some of that can be out of necessity if they don't have proper supply to food or things like that. However, generally speaking, all living things can sort of fall into this category. As a simple review once again, if you have plants that have the ability to do photosynthesis and take energy from the sun to make their own food internally. So all plants tend to have that ability, so we put them into the producer category. You then have living things that get their energy, like us, by eating other things that are found on the planet, whether it be plants or other animals. And we consider those to be consumers because they consume what they have. And then finally, there's the little things, the decomposers that break down the rest and eat the leftover dead or waste material. And combined, this can be used to organize the entire biosphere. I like to remember it like producers make their own food, consumers take their food and eat it, and decomposers break down their food and eat it that way. So the make, take, and break of the biosphere is how I choose to remember it. But at the end of the day, how you remember it is entirely up to you. So on the final page of your notebooks, guys, we have a little bit of a practice here. You'll see it looks just like this. You're going to see a number of different images showing different living things from the biosphere. What I want you to go ahead and do is drag each picture into one of the three categories as either a producer, a consumer, or a decomposer, right, in terms of which group you think it belongs to. Drag all of them in to sort of show that you have examples for each. Feel free to use your notes on the past page to help you figure out which ones should go where. So appreciate you guys coming on and watching this video. This is a little bit of an overview on how our biosphere is organized, how all living things acquire energy, and by looking at how they do that, we can organize them in a few different ways. That's going to be super important going forward, because starting next week, we're going to take a look at how producers and consumers kind of need each other and how their exchange of energy kind of works out. And when we look at the biosphere as a whole, we can kind of track that energy and see how all living things are interconnected. So we're going to talk about that in our next video. As always, if you guys have any questions about anything, you can leave me a comment on the assignments on Google Classroom and I'll respond right away. Friendly reminder as well, if you're watching this on Wednesday when it is released, that on Wednesdays the 6th grade team has their office hours from 8:15 to 9:15, so I'll have a Google Meet up if you want to stop by and ask any questions. Otherwise, leave a comment and I will get back to you right away. With that being said, make sure you guys check Power School and make sure all of your grades are up to date before you leave school today. And if you need anything, let me know. Otherwise, have an awesome day and I'll see you guys later.